Good afternoon and Sawasdee krap. So my topic is about ASEAN communities amidst the post-COVID Indo-Pacific conflicts. And I'm so happy that I'm the last presenter because I think most of our honorable panelists already mentioned the big point and the most important point already. I'll try very hard to present the thing that may be left over. And as Dr. Miyamiki mentioned earlier, you know, we trade economists always get blamed because we use the past data to forecast the future. So in order to fix these problems and to study this paper, I use the inductive future foresight method, start by doing the strategic intelligence scanning. And when Ajahn Sudipan told me to study about the Indo-Pacific thing, so I start from the map. And I'm the student of Professor Fukunari Kimura. So when I see the map, I think about product fragmentations, about international production network, and of course, global value chains. So for the global value chains, I think this is the thing that assembly by the three pillars. The first one is the US. And of course, if we combine the mainstream economic with the political scientist ideologies of, you know, international relations, we see the US is at the end of American world order, like Professor Amitav explained to us yesterday. And then we also see another new power from China, who is also seeking for economic opportunities with the lead mega project, so-called Belt and Road Initiatives, since the year 2012. And of course, last but not least, before the global COVID-19 pandemic, another important pillars of the regional global value chain is the European Union. Okay, European Union may lost the abilities to be the hegemon since the end of World War II, but European Union still established the international norms and standards. So these three regional value chains combine into a global value chain. And these global value chains before COVID-19 pandemic, the value of this GVC is about $18 trillion. Unfortunately, this value dropped significantly after the year 2020, and it hit the bottom at the year 2021. And there are so many consultant firms as well as economists forecast that by the year 2000, by the mid of 2021, up to the year 2023, this global value chain will recover again to the back value of $18 trillion. But the players in this global value chain may change because we see Japan, who is the investor that control the regional value chain in Asia. We also see the Bay of Bengal, and I totally agree with Professor Kimura that the Bay of Bengal, South Asia, should be integrated into these Asia factories. And of course, since I'm in Thailand, Thailand is very, very tiny in this global value chain. But when we combine into a ASEAN economic communities, it creates some kind of momentums and put ASEAN to have a foothold in this global value chains. So by the estimations that the phase of this global value chain by the year 2023 will be changed significantly because we see the value of trade and investment between US and EU will be stabilized, where the volume of trades between US, between EU and China also contracted. But we see an increase in the value of trade between EU and ASEAN. Exactly the same thing also happens to the flows between US and Asia as well. We see the value of trade continue to expand with ASEAN, but contracted with China. Trade war still there. And yesterday, so many professors already mentioned it in this prestige conference. And of course, because of the new coming of China, we see the Indo-Pacific strategies released by US. In 2017, US security strategies, followed by the expansion of US Pacific Command into US Indo-Pacific Command in the year 2018, followed by Indo-Pacific strategies of the Department of Defense in the year 2019. And in this year, 2021, we see the Quad Summit, and of course, B3W in Cornwall, that did talk a lot about Build Back Better World, which is the competitive project to Belt and Road Initiatives. So this US forward defense ring did happens, and it's changed the environment of our, you know, economic activities in these regions, at least to the next 5 or 10 years. But not only the Indo-Pacific strategies from the US to contain China and China BRI that try to expand its influence out of this defense ring, we also see other form of disrupt into our map as well. Other form of disrupt into our map are the disruptive technologies, of course. We see the change in global value chain, like I mentioned to you earlier. We see the change in logistic systems, as well as the new normal of unilateralism. Like Dr. Menon already mentioned earlier, unilateralism come in many names, right? And right now we use the word resilient on this thing. And of course, if you see the disrupt, if we do the strategic intelligence scanning about our near futures under this, you know, VUCA, volatilities, uncertainty, complexities, and ambiguity, COVID-19 pandemic, we see the disruptive technologies, blockchain, digital currencies, cryptocurrencies, like Dr. Menon mentioned earlier, it may help the SME in order to get access to international production network, in order to, you know, gain some benefits from global value chains. Of course, it's come with some complications. Hence, technology inequality may be the obstacle to the SME in order to utilize these digital smart tokens, these digital contracts. Unfortunately, if we watch into a longer terms, like in the next 15 or 20 years, this blockchain and digital cryptocurrency may be disrupted again by the coming quantum 2.0 technologies, because this is the dawn of these technologies right now. And it takes some time, about 12 up to 15 years, in order to find the real applications of this quantum 2.0. But definitely, this quantum 2.0 will disrupt these digital technologies again. Another problem with, you know, countries in South Asia and in ASEAN, you know, Indo-Pacific region, is about the energy. The energy's production and consumptions. We did know a lot that, you know, we changed the trend of energy production and consumption to be prosumer. Households can produce energies and consume energies and sell the rest of them to the systems with the power grid systems. We see the development of alternative sources of energies. But unfortunately, there are so many studies to confirm that at least by the year 2035, South Asia, India, and ASEAN still depend their source of energies from fossil energies. And this is the problems, because all the new trade barriers come with the ideologies of environmental protections. We see the change in global value chain. Like I told you earlier, it start to recover mid of this year, at least to the year 2023. But the standard, the detail of this GVC in the next 2-3 years will change because of this internet, in industry 4.0, internet of thing. We see the change in logistics, right? Because of the COVID-19 right now in Southeast Asia, we face with the big problems of we run out of container box, and the freight cost is increased at least 2,000 up to 200 to 300% for the one shipment from Southeast Asia to either European countries or to the US. So this is a thing that creates so many problems, because even we can still produce and export, but we cannot export because of the freight cost, because of the logistic cost, and we don't have a means of transportation. Another thing that related to geopolitics is the situation in South China Sea, right? There are so many forecasts that it's very easy to create, you know, to have like accident in South China Sea within the next 7 to 10 years. And if the South China Sea trade route is paralyzed, there are also some economists that calculate the 5 economies that are gonna suffer the most if something happened in South China Sea. The first one is Taiwan. The second one, Hong Kong. The third one, Vietnam. The fourth one, Singapore. And the fifth one, Thailand. So 3 out of 5 of the countries who suffer the most from South China Sea accident will be ASEAN member states. And of course, we see a new mean of transportation as well, because by the 2nd of December this year, the railway BRI, Belt and Road Initiative Railway, to connect Laos PDR from the capital city of Vientiane to any part in European countries will be fully operate. And you take only 22 up to 25 days to ship one container box from the borders of Thailand to any places in European countries, with the cost about double compared to normal sea freight costs. And I mentioned to you earlier, right now, the sea freight cost is not in the normal level. It's about 200 up to 300% increase from the normal level. Hence, we may change the logistic system from sea shipment, sea transportation to railway. And of course, this creates so many ideas of creating economic corridors as well as special economic zone that try very hard in order to link ASEAN, in order to link Southeast Asia with South Asia. Apart from that, we also see the new normal. Climate crisis will introduce us so many new kind of trade measures, trade barriers. For example, European countries just announced at the G7 meeting that they are going to levy the carbon content of imports instead of import tariffs. And it will start in the year 2023 and fully implement in the year 2025. Countries, so many countries around the world still suffer from global financial crisis, from subprime crisis. They spend so many quantitative easing, and then they create another big debt to do economic stimulus package during this COVID-19 pandemic. Hence, after pandemic, we see all countries doing tax reform. That means we will see the introductions of new kinds of trade barriers. For example, cross-border service trades, e-service trades will be subject to this tax, will be subject to these tariffs. And these tariff schemes, these climate change-related trade measures will be in the fashions of unilateralism. Because like Dr. Menon mentioned earlier, we use the good excuse of resilience in order to release this kind of new unilateralism. The problem is all these, you know, bubble is interlinkages. That make the problems is even more complex. So my recommendations in order to deal with this kind of situations for Indo-Pacific or ASEAN India, I recommend three reforms. The three reforms are peopleware, of course, hardware and software. For peopleware, I think the new mindset, the foreign policy that focus on preserving regional interest, because our regional Indo-Pacific is in between sandwich of China Belt and Road and B3W US containment policy. So we need to preserve our regional interest by balancing these superpower nations. And of course, to focus on preserving this regional interest sometimes may conflict with individual national interest. That means we need to talk more. We need more people-to-people connectivities. And we need to develop our human resources. I think India are so keen on this area. Vietnam also very good in this area, as well as Japan. We may need to develop our human in at least three dimensions: digital literacies, trade and financial literacies, and last but not least, 21st century is in need complex problem solving skills. For hardware, as I mentioned to you earlier, by the next 20 years, quantum technology will disrupt digital technologies. So we need to focus our infrastructure development to focus on advanced and future technologies, especially quantum technologies. We can learn from China. We can learn from India. They are the leads in this, you know, quantum supremacy, quantum advantages. And of course, we need to develop logistic infrastructure so that Southeast and South Asian regions can connect with each other as well as other regions. We need to talk more about ASEAN BIMSTEC centralities, and without interference from external power are very, very necessary. ASEAN outlook on the Indo-Pacific can be used as the role model because, you know, after ASEAN outlook on the Indo-Pacific that mentioned all kinds of connectivities, either Belt and Road or B3W, need to be concordance with ASEAN master plan on ASEAN connectivities. It's followed by agreement between ASEAN China, ASEAN Japan, ASEAN Plus 3, and ASEAN World Bank to build the concordances infrastructure in these regions. So we may need to do it with BIMSTEC, with South Asia. Unfortunately, until now, we still don't see this kind of standing point from the Bay of Bengal on how to deal with this, you know, trade war, technology war, logistic war in our regions. For the software, I totally agree with our, you know, honorable panelists that the XRLA, the Progressive Free Trade Agreement negotiations and implementation is the most important. Rules of origins are the highest priorities. We have to talk more about how to invite and expand other countries to join RCEP. We need to realize BIMSTEC. And of course, we need to rethink about Thailand, India, FTA, as well as in India, FTA. Last but not least, for the software, we need a reform for the framework of cooperations among member countries. Now we have so many kinds of economic cooperations. BIMSTEC has 14 areas of cooperations. Unfortunately, we still cannot fully utilize that kind of thing. So this is the thing that we may need to review again. So thank you very much, Ajahn Sutipan. I return the mic to you.
Thank you, Professor Piti. It's now-